Southern trees bear strange fruit. Blood on the leaves and blood at the root. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
I'm Bob Lederer with John Riley in Chicago. In this two-part segment on OutFM, we're going to discuss some of the many ways that this country's criminal justice system targets lesbians, gay men, bisexuals, and transgenders, LGBT people, particularly those who are working class, people of color, and gender non-conforming, for mistreatment, discrimination, and abuse. We'll especially be focusing on a book published earlier this year titled Queer Injustice, The Criminalization of LGBT People in the United States by Joey Mogul, Andrea Ritchie, and Kay Whitlock. Today, in part one, we'll pose the question, is abolition of the death penalty a queer issue? We're joined now by one of those three authors, Joey Mogul. She's a partner at the People's Law Office, a civil rights law firm here in Chicago, and is also director of the Civil Rights Clinic at DePaul University College of Law. Mogul's practice focuses on representing individuals who have suffered from police and other governmental misconduct in civil rights cases, and defending individuals in criminal and capital cases. Mogul has worked to seek justice for Chicago police torture survivors for the last 14 years. Her practice has also included representation of lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgendered people in criminal and civil proceedings involving police and prisoner torture, abuse, and misconduct. She has spoken widely before both legal and popular audiences on the state's use of homophobic, sexist, and racist arguments in criminal cases, and has devised legal training to counter such efforts. Mogul has also worked as an activist with Queer to the Left, the Midwest Coalition for Human Rights, and others to challenge the death penalty, torture by law enforcement officials, gentrification, and supermax prison conditions. Joey, thanks for joining us on OutFM.
Thanks for having me.
Well, we're recording this interview just 2 days after the horrendous miscarriage of justice represented by the execution of Troy Davis, a black man, by the state of Georgia for a murder of a white policeman that the evidence shows he did not commit. Last night, a New York-based LGBT liberation group called Queerocracy held the first of a week of die-ins to be held in Times Square at 11:08 p.m. each day, the exact time of Troy Davis's murder, in order, as they put it, quote, to represent lives like Troy Davis's that have been taken by an unjust judicial system. Queerocracy stands in solidarity with concerned New York City and United States residents to challenge the corrupt system that put an end to Troy Davis's life. They fear a complacent society where people sit back and allow the state to take the life of a man with no physical evidence or credible eyewitness testimony, unquote. Now, Joey Mogul, you had personal experience more than 20 years ago with a somewhat similar death penalty case involving two black men in Alabama falsely charged with murdering a white woman. So why don't you just start by telling us a little about that case and kind of the lessons and parallels to what happened to Troy Davis.
Well, I had the great honor and privilege to work for the Southern Center for Human Rights as an intern in 1991. In that case, two African-American men, Olin Grimsley, and I'm forgetting the co-defendant's name, were wrongfully accused of killing a white woman in Abbeville, Alabama. The co-defendant had gone to trial, and not only was he convicted, but he was given the death sentence. And he was represented by an attorney who had no prior death penalty experience. Olin was represented as well by a family law attorney originally who had just passed the bar, who had no capital defense experience, but she brought in the Southern Center for Human Rights. And what happened is the Southern Center went to Abbeville and they were looking into the case, and it was very clear that from the get-go, almost all the white people in that town wanted to kill and execute both of the individuals. and many African Americans were very fearful of stepping into the criminal legal system because of all of its tragic and persecutory consequences. But through the representation of the Southern Center and many African American folks coming to Olin's defense, he fortunately was given a mistrial, and there was a change of venue. Eventually, he was allowed to plead to get, to get a sentence which allowed him to get out. But I think it demonstrated just how biased the system was from the get-go, and how the lack of really any resources and skilled defense attorneys prevented justice in that case. Fortunately, the Southern Center went back and was able to save the life of the co-defendant, but it was marred from the get-go.
Well, since your work as an intern on that case, you have represented defendants as an attorney in several capital cases, and you've also researched, as part of your work in putting together this book, Queer Injustice, a lot of other cases. And in the book, you and your two co-authors write, quote, "Criminalizing narratives help build a case that people of color kill intentionally in a particularly cruel and crude manner and are therefore more deserving of death. Moreover, the lives of their victims, if they are white, are often portrayed as having greater value. These dynamics illustrate why a black person is four times more likely to receive the death penalty for killing a white person than if he or she kills a person of the same race, or than a white person who kills a person of any race. Queer people, both of color and white, are also tried before juries comprised primarily of heterosexual, gender-conforming people, whose members often have beliefs that LGBT people are deviant and immoral. One study found that jurors in death penalty cases, who must be, quote, death qualified, unquote, that is, express a willingness to hand down a death sentence, are more likely to possess racist, sexist, and homophobic views and are therefore presumably more likely to be easily swayed by raced or queer criminalizing narratives. So, Joey, can you discuss how all these dynamics of racism, sexism, and homophobia play out in death penalty cases as you described in the book, and particularly talk about the case of Bernina Mata?
Sure. You know, when it comes to the death penalty, what's important for people to understand is that you don't get the death penalty for every single murder. In fact, it's a very few, only 1.2% of all murder cases become capital death penalty cases. And the fact is, it's really should be, and it is in most cases, it's very difficult to get the death penalty. It's a difficult feat, because what you have to do is you have to convince 12 human beings to kill another human being. And what we find when you look at the death penalty cases is that the way to do that, the way that prosecutors succeed in convincing 12 people to kill another, is to dehumanize the defendant. And what they do is they play into what these racist, sexist, homophobic, and anti-gender variant biases in order to dehumanize the defendant and convince them to kill. And that's why we see a disproportionate number of people of color on death row, because we see both men and women of color are often branded with racist stereotypes that depict them as animalistic, as hypersexual, as hyperviolent, and that then results in not only their convictions, but in their death sentences. Those same dynamics are at play when you see an individual who's either queer or easily portrayed as queer in death penalty cases. Because as we discuss in Queer Injustice, there are these archetypes out in the ethos that brand us as inherently violent, inherently untrustworthy, and inherently criminal and pathological as queers. And these come to play and they get manifested in these queer death penalty cases. So for example, in Bernita Mata's case, Bernita Mata's a Latina lesbian who was accused of killing a white heterosexual man in Boone County, Illinois in 1998. It's a rural county about an hour and a half here from Chicago. And the circumstances that indicate that both Bernita Mata and her roommate, Russell Grunmeier, were involved in this man's murder. John Draham was a white heterosexual man who Bernita Mata had met at a bar the very same evening as his death. There was evidence that he was flirting with her and that he went home with her to her apartment, and that at her apartment, he was stabbed to death. And there's evidence that implicates both Bernita Mata and her roommate, Russell Grunmeier, a white heterosexual man. And there's evidence, without a doubt, that both of them took acts to conceal John Draham, the victim's death. But what happened in this case is that both Bernita Mata's race and her sexual orientation absolutely played a role in deciding who was going to get the death penalty. What the state, the prosecutors did, is they chose not to seek the death penalty against the white heterosexual co-defendant, and instead they cut him a deal. In exchange for him testifying against Bernita Mata, he was given immunity for his participation in the murder and 4 years for his acts in concealing the victim's death. He today is a free man. And instead, what happened is, in terms with respect to his testimony, he helped to not only convict Bernita Mata, but get her the death sentence. So what happened is, in that case, is not only did her race and her sexual orientation play a role in deciding whether the prosecutor was going to charge her, but the prosecutor then used her race and her sexual orientation to convince the jury to both convict and kill her. In Bernita Mata's case, they had to prove there was some aggravating circumstance that made this a death-eligible case. And they had to prove it was more heinous than just a typical murder, and that was going to be very difficult to do. The one aggravating factor that they relied on was they alleged that this was some cold, calculated, premeditated murder, and that made it a death-eligible case. But the circumstances really belied that. She had never met the victim before. She had only met him hours before his death. There was evidence they were all drunk. And in Bernita Mata's case, she has serious mental health issues that really undermine the idea that she intentionally killed or hatched this elaborate plan. And in fact, as Bernita Mata said when she was arrested, she believed that the victim was trying to rape her. And she previously was raped as a child. As a 4-year-old, she was raped by her stepfather and raped so severely that she had to be hospitalized and she had to have an operation in order to be sewn back up. So she's clearly a damaged individual who has had a lifelong of suffering and abuse and mental health issues that truly undermined whatever mental capacity the state was trying to depict to make her seem some cold, calculated, premeditated murderer. But what the state then did was is they really relied on her race and sexual orientation to depict her as this cold person. And specifically, they relied on what we describe in the book as the man-hating lesbian, this archetypal representation that depicts lesbians as hating men and prone to violence. They also really tapped into this racist archetype that paints Latina women as being hysterical and prone to violence in the heat of passion. And by doing this, they were really able to demonize her. And, you know, we're not just speculating. If you look at the prosecutor's tactics in the case, it demonstrates how they were absolutely using her sexual orientation to prejudice her in front of the jury and demonize her to get the death penalty. So what they did in this case was they argued that her evidence of her lesbianism was relevant to the murder. And in fact, they said she was, quote, a hardcore lesbian, unquote, and that her hardcore lesbianism is what caused her to kill. They said her lesbianism was the motive for the murder. And I think it's important for us to step back and think about that. I mean, have we ever heard of a case in America or in the United States where we've seen any heterosexual person had their heterosexuality prescribed as the reason why they committed the murder? I mean, if you think about Ted Bundy, he killed scores of women. And never once was it argued that his heterosexual orientation is what caused him to kill. But in this case, the state had no qualms and no shame getting up and arguing that her lesbianism caused her to kill. And what's so unfortunate and tragic is back in 1998, little over a decade ago, a court in Boone County allowed evidence for lesbianism to be used as an argument as to her motive for killing. So what the state then did was not only argue that her lesbianism caused her to kill, but they paraded her lesbianism throughout the trial in order to prejudice her in front of the jury. So they called 10 witnesses to the stand who all testified she was a lesbian, even though that was so irrelevant. They went and they took 3 books off the shelves of her home. I mean, very vanilla, benign texts, in my opinion. Things like homosexuality, call me lesbian, and a book that was from the Kinsey Institute, all with titles that had lesbian or homosexuality in it. And they didn't even let the jurors read the book, but they just presented the titles of the books to the jury to say, see, this is proof that she's a lesbian. And then throughout their arguments to the jury, on 17 different occasions, they cited her lesbianism. And then they had the audacity during their arguments to claim that Bernardita Mata was overtly homosexual, that she was proclaiming her sexuality to anyone who listened, and that she flaunted her sexuality. When it was clear, in fact, that the state was flaunting her sexuality before this jury, because they knew it would prejudice her, get the jury to hate her, and kill her. And there's evidence that one of the jurors in this case, in the midst of questioning prior to becoming a juror, admitted that he thought homosexuality was immoral. So he was ripe to such arguments to believe that her lesbianism in and of itself made her less worthy of living and worthy of death. And as a result, Bernardita Mata was sentenced to death in 1998.
And lest any of our listeners think that this was just an isolated case in one rural county in Illinois, maybe you could just more briefly summarize some of the other cases cited in the book and just the general pattern of what happens to lesbian and gay accused murderers when prosecutors seek the death penalty, and what the evidence you found that that homophobic imagery and stereotypes are used to bring about the death penalty in several of those cases.
Sure. It was through representing Bernardita Mata that I grew to understand that there's this disturbing pattern of cases where prosecutors intentionally and deliberately use a person's sexual orientation or gender non-conforming appearance in order to dehumanize them. So, for example, in J. Wesley Neal's case, J. Wesley Neal was accused of committing a bank robbery in which four individuals were killed and three were harmed. I'm not in any way denying that it was a horrific crime and it was a heinous one at that. But, you know, J. Wesley Neal, again, had extenuating, mitigating circumstances, not to excuse the crimes he committed, which were violent and which were heinous, but which I think mitigated whether he should get a life sentence or not. He had a horrific child upbringing, and he suffered a great deal of homophobia throughout his life. And he came to show remorse and apologize to the victims and really regret what he's done. And so the question becomes, why would we want to kill this person? They are not going to cause any danger. And what do we gain from having him executed? But the state, in arguing that he should be convicted, the prosecutor absolutely used his gay identity. In such a naked and shameless way, he got up during the penalty phase of the proceedings, and he told the jury that when deciding whether J. Wesley Neal should live or die, they should consider who he is. And the prosecutor then said, you should consider the fact that J. Wesley Neal is an avowed homosexual. That's the life you're determining of an avowed homosexual, which clearly was indicating that he was less of a human being because he was gay. What's unfortunate is that through J. Wesley Neal's appeals, the court even understood that that was a homophobic, prejudicial, and unconscionable argument. But they found that it was harmless error, and J. Wesley Neal was executed in 2003, despite the homophobic nature of his prosecution. Wanda Jean Allen was an African-American lesbian, a butch woman accused of killing her lover in a domestic dispute. And in that case, there was evidence that there was fighting. Wanda Jean Allen claimed that she was the victim and that she was defending herself against her lover, who was an African-American lesbian. And the state was saying that Wanda Jean Allen was the aggressor, who was in fact the abuser who killed her lover. So in this case, you have evidence that both individuals were violent with one another. And in fact, both Wanda Jean Allen and her lover, who was killed, had both committed a murder and had served time. But what the state did was they argued that Wanda Jean Allen was like the man in the family, and they really focused on her gender non-conforming nature, specifically her real butch identity. By telling the jury she, you know, acted like a man, that she was the man in the family, that she wore the pants in the family. And in fact, went so far to even mock her because she spelled her middle name Jean, G-E-N-E, in a masculine way. And they used that to say, see, as the man in the family, she was the aggressor in the family, and therefore she was responsible for the murder. Again, you know, whether she's butch or not has no evidence, and it has no correlation to whether, in fact, she committed the murder or not. But they knew that this jury in Oklahoma would find it sick and perverted and immoral that somehow she transgresses this gender boundary. And the jury not only convicted her, they sentenced her to die, and unfortunately, in 2003, she too was executed. And one other striking case that I'll share with you, although there are many others, we look to the case of Calvin Burdine from Texas. Many people may have heard of Calvin Burdine's case because he has a case where he had deplorable defense counsel representing him at trial. And he was represented by the ACLU because his defense counsel, in fact, had fallen asleep on two to five separate occasions during his defense. Fortunately, the courts found that, yes, that was ineffective assistance of counsel, and therefore he should get a new trial. What is not known by many individuals out there is that Calvin Burdine was gay, and he was accused of killing his lover, and the state used his gay identity to get him the death sentence. What they, in fact, argued to the jury in the penalty phase is that you couldn't send Calvin Burdine to prison because life for a homosexual isn't that bad, quote unquote.
Life in prison.
Life in prison isn't that bad for a homosexual, which in essence was like saying sending a gay man to prison is like sending a kid to a candy store. And what they were doing is they were really tapping into this idea, this archetype, that gay men, that other queers, that we are sexually degraded predators. You know, that we are hypersexual, we are obsessed with sex, and there's no idea whatsoever of a gay man or others not being able to consent to sex, which is just, it's not only shameful, it's just unconscionable for a prosecutor to argue that, because when you look at the reality of the way gay men, trans women, butch lesbians are treated in prison, they are the ones who are targeted for the most sexual violence. And they are the ones who are humiliated and punished and subject to the most ugliest forms of abuse while in prison. So the idea that this prosecutor would make such a homophobic argument and get away with it is, to be honest, it's just unpalatable. So these are just a few of the cases we see where people's sexual orientation or gender identity are used against them to kill them.
We're speaking with Joey Mogul, who's an attorney. He's represented several defendants in capital cases and many, many cases involving police torture and brutality. And she's also one of the co-authors, along with Andrea, Ritchie, and Kay Whitlock, of the book Queer Injustice, The Criminalization of LGBT People in the United States. Now, Joey, your involvement in the Bernina Mata case and your research on all these other cases that you've described is not simply a scholarly endeavor. In 2002, were active with the Chicago group Queer to the Left and helped lead a campaign that cited the injustice of Bernina Mata's death sentence as Exhibit A in a broader campaign to commute the sentences of all prisoners on death row in Illinois at that time. And this included a letter-writing campaign in LGBT communities, a press conference, and an ad in a gay newspaper calling on the community to, quote, come out against the death penalty and in support of justice. And thanks in part to this LGBT support of the clemency campaign, in 2003, Governor George Ryan, just before leaving office, commuted all existing death sentences, including Bernina Mata's, and declared the system, quote, deeply flawed, arbitrary, and haunted by the demon of error, unquote. Now, after further struggle by the movement to abolish capital punishment, in March of this year, 2011, Illinois became the 14th state in the past quarter century to abolish the death penalty. And in the book, you and your co-authors write, quote, many more possibilities exist for anti-death penalty groups and queers to work together to develop campaigns that illustrate how the death penalty is built on criminalizing archetypes and jointly advocate for its abolition, unquote. So, especially in the wake of the absolutely unjust execution of Troy Davis, talk to us about the lessons of the campaign you were part of with Queer to the Left and some of the others mentioned in the book in the queer community over the last few years, and what can people take as ideas for the future?
Well, I think it's important to note that there are a lot of us, a lot of queers out there who do anti-death penalty work, who do prison work, who fight the injustices in the criminal legal system, regardless of the fact of whether it affects us as queers or not, because we just recognize that if there's an injustice anywhere, it affects us all. I think, though, what was rewarding to us in working in Queer to the Left on the death penalty campaign in Illinois was to recognize that, in fact, there are a lot of people in the gay communities who are opposed to the death penalty. But because our mainstream organizations don't highlight that as an issue, it doesn't often get the attention it deserves. So by going out there and organizing as queers to come out against the death penalty, we tapped into an amazingly huge resource of people who were willing to come out and make phone calls and attend and write letters and attend press conferences to let Governor Ryan know that there was support in the queer community. And I think that was hugely important. I think it was hugely important for the queer communities to see that so that others in the community could recognize that that's something that should be a queer issue and that's something that should be on people's and agendas. And it was important for straight communities and straight politicians to realize that that too was an issue. Because I'll say, with respect to Governor Ryan, he was an amazingly courageous politician who did the right thing. He didn't just do the right thing with the death penalty. He was also very supportive of LGBT communities, and he had LGBT staff. And it was important for the queer community to be able to reach out to Governor Quinn and reach out to those LGBT staff members and recognize we do take this into account when we decide who we're going to vote for and not. And so there's many levels I think it's important, and there were many lessons I learned about being out and doing this work.
Of course, efforts to involve the LGBT movement in opposing the death penalty are not always an easy sell, and sometimes are quite controversial, especially, as you mentioned, among the more mainstream organizations. Now, this issue came to a head nationally in 1999 in the wake of the highly publicized gay-bashing murder of Matthew Shepard, a gay man in Wyoming. As you and your co-authors write in Queer Injustice, quote, shortly after the prosecutor's decision to bring capital charges against Shepard's accused killers was announced, Queer Watch, a national network of radical gay activists, launched a campaign opposing the death penalty for Shepard's murderers and called on prominent national lesbian gay organizations to do the same, unquote. And then you all go on to explain how the national conservative gay log cabin Republicans strongly opposed that position. They urged that the death penalty, in fact, be sought. And a spokesperson for the largest and best-funded national lesbian gay rights organization, the Human Rights Campaign, said, quote, we don't have a policy on the death penalty, and we don't see it as a particularly gay issue, unquote. But eventually, 12 LGBT organizations, many of them national in scope, announced their opposition to the death penalty not only in the Shepard case, but in all cases. In the end, both of Shepard's killers negotiated plea bargains in which they got double life sentences. But for the second murderer, this only occurred after conviction by the jury. So, Joey Mogul, in the book Queer Injustice, you and your co-authors write, quote, clearly, abolition of the death penalty is a queer issue, but LGBT activists must move beyond issuing statements and press releases to mounting active campaigns. So, why don't you sum up for us why you believe, and you've already addressed this, but just kind of summarize why you think the death penalty is in fact a queer issue, and what specifically you would recommend, again, in the wake of the national outcry over the execution of Troy Davis, and, you know, keeping in mind this new initiative of queerocracy in New York to have these daily die-ins in the street. What are some of your ideas about how the LGBT community can make its voice heard in opposition to the death penalty?
Well, I mean, I think the death penalty is a queer issue because, as the statistics demonstrate, the death penalty absolutely has to do with whose lives are valued and whose not. That's why there are a disproportionate number of black people on death row, because as a society, we devalue the lives of black people. And that's why when a person kills a white person, they're more likely to get the death penalty because white people's lives are valued. And that's why we, and you know, as queers, we understand that people devalue us, they devalue our lives, they devalue our love, and they devalue our sex. And so we should understand that any system that devalues human life must be taken on and it must be abolished. So clearly it is a queer issue. I think that what we need to recognize in queer communities, and particularly the LGBT mainstream organizations, is that these injustices affect all human lives, including queer lives, those who are of color, and those who are gender non-conforming, and those who are working class, as you state. And if we are gonna, if these LGBT mainstream organizations are gonna say they represent our communities, then represent everyone in our communities, including those most marginalized. The fact is, while the death penalty is in existence, not only are we gonna see people's lives snuffed out, like Troy Davis, and like Wanda Jean Allen, J. Wesley Neal, our queer brothers and sisters, okay? But we can then not get to the other issues that are plaguing our criminal legal system that are unjust to the core, that affect large numbers of those marginalized queers in our community. So we're currently living in an age of a crisis of mass incarceration, where we see people imprisoned for years and years on end for nonviolent crimes. But while the death penalty is still in existence, it's very difficult to get at these other issues with the criminal legal system when we have to galvanize all of our forces to try to save people's lives. And while it was beautiful and it was amazing to see everyone come out for Troy Davis, I wish we could see those numbers on behalf of all of the individuals who are currently executed or being lined up for execution in our country. So for me, what we need to see is we need to see a dramatic shift in the agendas of queer organizations. And we need to join with the Audre Lorde Project, the Streetwise and Safe group that Andrea Ritchie works with, our co-author, and with Sylvia Rivera Law Project, that make issues around the criminal legal system a priority, that works to seek to gut the injustice of these criminalizing processes.